Imagine receiving a message you never even see.
No link, no attachment you have to click on.
And yet, within seconds, your phone is just completely taken over. We're talking about your camera, your microphone, all your private chats, everything, silently streamed to somebody else.
Now, this isn't something out of a sci-fi movie. This is real. It's called Pegasus, probably the most advanced, most sophisticated spyware ever built for a smartphone. It was created by an Israeli company, the NSO Group, and sold to governments all over the world. So in this explainer, we're going to break down exactly how Pegasus works, how it can infect a phone without a single click, and most importantly, what you can do to protect yourself. All right, so here's what we're going to cover. First, we'll look at the ghost in the machine, what Pegasus actually is. Then we'll get into its biggest, scariest secret, the zero-click attack. After that, we'll walk through the anatomy of the hack, step by step. We'll also look at the global impact, the human cost, and how Apple decided to fight back. And we'll wrap up with some real, practical steps for building your own digital shield.
Okay, let's dive right in. First up, what exactly is this ghost in the machine?
So it's really important to get this straight. Pegasus is not your average malware. This is military-grade stuff. You know, don't think of it like a simple virus some hacker built to steal credit card numbers. No, no. Think of it more like a top-tier cyber espionage platform, the kind of thing designed for powerful intelligence agencies with, frankly, almost unlimited resources.
And what it can do is, well, it's staggering. We're not just talking about stealing the data that's already on your phone. We're talking about a complete and total takeover of the device. It can read your messages, even the encrypted ones from apps like Signal and WhatsApp. It can listen to your calls, track your GPS location, and this is the really crazy part, it can silently turn on your microphone and camera. It literally turns your own phone into a live surveillance bug that you carry around in your pocket.
Okay, so that leads to the big chilling question, right? How on earth does it get into your phone in the first place? Well, this is where we get to its most powerful and frankly, most terrifying weapon, the zero-click secret.
You see, this is what truly sets Pegasus apart and makes it so dangerous. It uses something called a zero-click vulnerability. What does that mean? It means it completely bypasses the human factor. You don't have to fall for a scam, you don't have to click a suspicious link or download a weird file. The attack just happens. It can be triggered the moment your phone receives a specific, specially crafted piece of data.
A perfect example of this is an exploit they called forced entry, which was discovered by the security researchers at Citizen Lab. Here's how it worked. An attacker would send a target's iPhone an iMessage, but this wasn't a normal message. It contained a malicious image file. Now your iPhone, in the background, tries to be helpful by creating a little preview of that image. It does this automatically. And that one simple, automatic action was enough to trigger a hidden flaw in the phone's software. And bam, the hack begins. All of this happens completely invisibly, without you ever even seeing a message or a notification.
Okay, so the spyware has its foot in the door. But how does that initial little foothold turn into a complete takeover? Well, it follows a pretty methodical process that experts in the field call a digital kill chain. It's a step-by-step attack. So after that initial trigger, the exploit works to escalate its privileges. Basically, it breaks out of this safe little sandbox that apps are supposed to live in, and it goes for deep, system-level control. Think of it like this. It's not just a key to one room anymore. It's the master key to the entire building, the whole operating system. Once it has that, it installs the main Pegasus agent. That agent then secretly phones home to its command and control servers to get its orders. And then it starts the final phase, exfiltrating your data.
And here's the really crucial takeaway. Once that implant is active, it's pretty much game over. The operators on the other end have total unrestricted access. And again, it's not just about grabbing the photos and messages that are already there. It's about actively controlling your phone to gather new intelligence, live, in real time.
So you have to understand, this technology wasn't just some lab experiment or a proof of concept. Oh no, it was deployed on a massive global scale, and it created a sprawling spy network that had a very, very real human cost.
Just to give you an idea of the scale we're talking about, forensic analysis has confirmed Pegasus infections in more than 45 countries. So this wasn't some boutique limited use tool, it was essentially a global surveillance product sold to governments all around the world.
Now the NSO Group always claimed its product was only meant to be used for tracking terrorists and serious criminals, but the target list, well, it tells a very different story. Investigations from groups all over the world revealed it was being used against journalists, human rights defenders, political activists, diplomats, even heads of state.
It effectively turned a tool that was supposed to be for national security into a weapon to silence dissent.
As you can imagine, the discovery of a weapon this powerful being aimed directly at its own products, well, it forced Apple to make a very swift, very decisive response. So let's talk about Apple's counterattack.
And the response really was incredibly fast. As soon as Citizen Lab figured out how the forced entry exploit worked, Apple rushed out an emergency software patch to close that hole. But they didn't just stop at patching. They took the fight further. They actually sued the NSO group. They started sending direct threat notifications to users who they believed were being targeted. And then they made a really fundamental change to their whole security philosophy.
That change was the introduction of lockdown mode. And this is a really fascinating feature because in a way it's Apple admitting that for some high-risk people, the default level of security just isn't enough. Lockdown mode is basically an optional emergency kill switch for the very features that these zero-click attacks love to target. Things like automatic link previews in iMessage and certain complex web technologies. Yep, it makes your phone a bit less convenient to use, but it makes it exponentially harder to hack.
All right, so this brings us to the most practical and probably the most important question for you. Knowing all this, what can you actually do? How do you build your own digital shield?
So does this mean we're completely defenseless against these kinds of threats?
The answer is no, absolutely not. But it does mean you have to be proactive about your own security.
So here are the most important things you can do. Number one, and this is non-negotiable, keep your operating system updated, always. Those security patches are your absolute first line of defense. Number two, if you're someone who might be a high-risk target, maybe you're a journalist, an activist, or you handle very sensitive information, seriously consider enabling lockdown mode. Number three, do not jailbreak your phone, ever. Doing that is basically like taking a sledgehammer to the security walls that Apple built to protect you. And finally, a good practice is to use separate devices for your sensitive work and your personal life if you can.
You know, when you look back at it, the whole Pegasus saga really teaches us one powerful lesson. The fight for our digital privacy, it isn't just about having the right tools or the most expensive phone, it's about awareness. Pegasus proved that even the world's most secure smartphones can be compromised. The real shield, the real defense, is understanding the threats that are out there and making conscious, informed choices to protect yourself.
And that really leaves us with one final big question to think about. In an age of truly invisible weapons, how do we even begin to defend a right, our privacy, that we can't even see being taken away from us?